everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Collider Jedi Council. I am Kristian Harloff, a.k.a. Darth Harloff, and this is our Star Wars show. That's why you're here. You like Star Wars. You want to hear about it? Well, you're watching right now. Or maybe you haven't. Maybe you've never seen Star Wars a day in your life, and like, what the hell are these people talking about? We're going to tell you. Joining me on the council today, it is Obi-John Kenobi. John Campy is here. What's up, John?
Hey, fresh, still kind of catching my breath, fresh off that exhilarating evening that you, me, Ellis, and spent together watching The Phantom Menace last night, doing our commentary. It was a long night.
We braved through it. And
yes, we did.
We have a very special guest on the show today. He is from theforcenet.com. It is Justin Bolger. How are you, Justin?
I am awesome. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited. It's an exciting week to be a Star Wars fan.
It really is. There's so much, and I always say this when we have a big supersized episode, because there's so much, the first thing I always say is I look into the camera and I say, sorry, Dennis. we have a lot of stories to talk about here. And if you're new to the show, the first topic that we usually talk about on this show is just the Star Wars movie news. It is everything happening in the world of the film. It could be the anthology films, it could be the saga films, whatever's happening, we are going to talk about it. And there has been a lot that has been happening in the Star Wars movie news.
No.
Yep. Since we last left this show last week. The first story up for grabs, and Mark Ellis is not here today, so I will be playing the role of Mark 2D2 in regards to the stories. It's all about Entertainment Weekly again. When Entertainment Weekly drops a story, they drop a Star Wars story. They seem to have been the hub this year for the Star Wars stories.
And they usually drop them in bunches.
They really do. Yeah. And it's like they'll come out. So for the first thing, look at all these pictures that Dennis has just put up here. There's a lot of really, really cool images, and we're going to talk about that first. And then there was stuff that came out even today as far as the interviews that went down as well too. So again, if you people are not are familiar with what happened, Entertainment Weekly dropped a really big kind of exclusive information about everything happening in The Force Awakens. Now let's look at these pictures here first. For me, the one that stands out for me is just because this way I get to say, hey, guess what, I think I was right, is the bottom right corner. When we saw the Comic-Con footage of the Stormtrooper walking Poe down the hallway, I said, that's Finn. I said, that's Finn. That's the beginning of the movie, and then he gets his jacket. It looks like I was right. Maybe I'm crazy. But if Justin, you look at these pictures. Out of the pictures here, what stands out to you the most?
God, Princess Leia, by far. I'm sorry, General Leia.
General Leia, far. Yeah.
A title she's had since 1983, but a lot of people are really picking up on this on social media right now and are really excited about it. But you just look at Carrie Fisher, and you see, as Harrison Ford said, you see the mileage on that face. She's been fighting this fight for a long time,
right,
and she's still in that moment.
It's true. And then, of course, what Justin's referring to as well, in the article, they talk about how she's not a princess anymore. It's more she's like a general. She's running it. And even if you go back to some of the books that were out there, they made reference to that. I believe it was in Moving Target, in the beginning of Moving Target, of where her position is and how much, like Justin said, mileage is on her. But John, you see the pictures here. Out of the images that you saw, what stood out to you?
Well, I got to point this out. I don't know who put it together or whatever, but if you look at the image in the top right there, or if we're facing screen this way, top left, whatever, yeah. Han and Chewie with their hands on their head. Somebody, a fantastic meme was making its way around online of what's Chewie and Han been up to since Return of the Jedi, and it's them like this, but they photoshopped in headphones with a mixer in front of them.
Funny.
Stuff like that. It looked so funny, so I just wanted to give a shout out to whoever put that meme together, because that was amazing. But yeah, it's the Princess Leia one.
Yeah.
Because when you look at it, the face is telling a story right now. I mean, that is the face of a leader in a perilous situation,
yeah,
right there. And that's what she has been. She has been a leader throughout all the Star Wars films, like right from the first time that we see her in Star Wars, the original film, all the way through to now. She has been that leader. A lot of these images look great. The Harrison Ford one with JJ is awful. Is obviously very revealing. You see some stuff going on there on set. That's great. Phasma looks amazing. Anytime you get to see BB-8 these days is really cool. But yeah, it's that Princess Leia one is the one to me that really stands out.
Yeah. Now, John, did you get a chance to shoot that? Did you shoot the image over to Dennis?
I did indeed.
We did. Okay. So yeah. Normally, like what happens on Movie Talk a lot of times and what happens on this show, a story might drop that's not something we were planning on covering, but now we can. John just sent an image over to Dennis, and it is the official IMAX poster of Star Wars The Force Awakens. this looks like it could be a book cover. It looks like it could be a comic cover. It looks like it is Star Wars. I love this photo. It is simple. It is exactly what I want it to be, and it is a nice representation of what we see in even that international trailer, which we'll talk about in a little bit, with Rey walking with BB-8. John, you see this poster. What do you think?
Breathtaking.
Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful. I love this poster. First of all, the walking into the sunset thing is very, and they've been doing this a lot with some of the marketing, is very reminiscent of that original scene on Tatooine, Luke standing there looking off, of course, at the time of the three suns.
Right.
But so this gives a little bit of sense of continuity. It's a totally different planet, though. We have two totally different characters. The composition of the image, you're right. It is also a very simple image, but there's a lot going on there when you really want to look at it from an artistic point of view. I am floored by this poster. I absolutely adore it.
Justin?
It's iconic. And yeah. It's iconic for all the reasons John was saying just now. It's a callback to everything that fans know about the single person on a planet that they don't think that they are anybody, or they don't think that they have any kind of relevance. And with the image coming from behind Rey, with BB-8 to her left, yeah, and seeing that sun come up, it calls back to mind Tatooine, it calls back to mind Star Wars, but it's Star Wars for a new generation. Here you have Rey, a brand new character, a female character, mm-hmm, and it tells you everything you need to know just by the words Star Wars there, but then also that desert planet again. I can't really express enough how iconic it is with being simple at the same time.
Right. It's beautiful. It really is. And it's a great representation of IMAX, because IMAX, for me, I mean, I'm always picking, and now it's kind of synonymous. You have 3D, you have to have IMAX, but IMAX for me is, I'm always picking first over anything. Like, if I have a chance to watch a movie in IMAX, and I think this is a movie that says, you want to see this movie in IMAX. That's what this poster, I think, says to me as well, too. Okay, so the next story here is something that's going to be near and dear to my heart, and get the Stormtrooper ready, because Daisy Ridley, inside of this Entertainment Weekly article, she talked about that staff. And she made mention here, I'm trying to find the actual quote, excuse me, but she was talking about the staff, and there were a lot of rumors going on. We've been part of those rumors.
Yes, we have.
Darth Plagueis, who is Emperor Palpatine, Darth Sidious Master, who Darth Sidious says that he killed in episode, he talked about it in episode 3, he said that he had killed him in his sleep, and there was a reference, maybe Snoke is Plagueis. Well, Daisy Ridley was asked about, not necessarily that, but is that staff Darth Plagueis's? And she was pretty much said, it's just a staff. That's all it is. It's just the staff. It's
uh-huh.
Stuff. Yes. All right, well, John, let's start with you. Uh-huh. So you hear this quote. I'm going to try to find the actual quote while you explain the reason you think she's BSing.
Yeah, it's just a staff. Yeah. Because just a staff, we would, in the poster, the official poster of the movie, we would have running parallel with the lightsaber of Kylo Ren. It's just a staff, so let's feature it on every single piece of marketing material there is out there. Have we ever seen Rey without that staff?
No.
Has she ever not have that staff? I don't think so. Also, there is, going back just a little ways now, going back to on Force Friday, when all those toys were released, one of those toys was a, I keep wanting to say Darth Ren. It's not. Oh. Kylo Ren. When there was a Kylo Ren doll,
right,
that came out that spoke, you know, and it says some things. Do you remember what one of those things he said is?
Yeah, you're talking about the weapon.
Talking about the weapon.
But you're talking about the one is, I want that weapon?
No, he said, the staff is mine.
Oh, does he say the staff is mine?
There's a line that says the staff is mine.
I think he said that weapon is mine. The weapon belongs to me.
I thought he said, no, I could be wrong. Now, even if I'm right,
yeah,
and clearly from your reaction, we've got to put an asterisk beside that. But even if I'm right, now remember, when we first talked about that story, I went and got my Star-Lord doll that also spoke, and it said about 20 lines that are not in Guardians of the Galaxy, because they make these dolls and they record these things long before the movie, or ages before, probably even before the movie starts shooting. But there are other reasons. I do believe very firmly that Snoke is Plagueis. I believe that wholeheartedly. I'm not going to say 100%. But I believe it a lot.
Again, we're going to get a little more into that, too, because Andy Serkis had a little something
to say
Serkis,
also. We'll get into that a bit. But that being the case, the similarities, the fact that there is so much onus being put on this staff.
Yeah.
Okay, Daisy, sure. I know you're doing your job. I know you're being told to say that.
Right.
So no, good on you. I'm not blaming you at all. But yeah, sure. Sure, it's just staff.
What do you think, Justin?
I have to respectfully disagree. I love Darth Plagueis. Palpatine's my favorite character. The Darth Plagueis book is fantastic. My favorite Star Wars book. I think we agree on that.
Yeah.
I think in this case, sometimes a staff is just a staff. I think that the parallel similarity that you're talking about, I'm of the mind that maybe Kylo Ren and Rey are related, and maybe that's why there's a parallel. One sibling chose the dark side. One sibling is stepping into the light, which is another great reflection on that poster, by the way.
Oh yeah, we believe that wholeheartedly,
yes,
too.
So we're good.
We're good there, yeah.
So they're creating that parallel, and they want you to see that there is a relation, but they can't tell you what that relation is right now up front. I think that the staff is a placeholder for maybe a double-sided lightsaber at some point that Rey is going to inherit or construct at some point in this trilogy. So if she's already proficient with a weapon that you wield as a staff, then when she gets that double-bladed lightsaber, it's a little bit more believable that she would be able to transition to something like that a little bit faster than someone with no Jedi training, right?
Now, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I believe the only shot I have ever seen Rey in where she is not in possession of the staff and the staff is highlighted was a quick glimpse in the trailer where for a moment she doesn't have it, but the reason she doesn't have it is because there's a close-up of the staff sticking in the sand and it's just her grabbing and picking up the staff. Other than that, as we see in the thing here, this is my biggest thing, is that every time, like Han Solo's gun is just a gun, but you see him sometimes with it and you see him without. She is always with that staff,
yeah,
and they're always highlighting it and always showing it, even in this new IMAX poster.
It's there. Now, but that being said, I don't disagree that the staff's going to have a very crucial part in this
significance
story.
Significance,
yes, absolutely, for her, as far as what it means to her, the fact that she relies on it, and it might eventually do exactly what Justin's saying in becoming this double-sided lightsaber. I don't think that means, God bless you, I don't think that means that it is Plagueis' staff. And now I'm not saying that Plagueis isn't in this movie. I'm just saying I don't necessarily know. Yeah, I know. Yeah, John showed us a shot of Daisy Ridley with a double-sided lightsaber, and it could be connected to the staff. Now I think that if this turned out to not be Darth Plagueis' staff, because look, Plagueis, I don't even remember Plagueis having a staff in the book.
He didn't.
I remember him having it in the toys. And when they released it in the toys, that's where this thing came from.
And that comes from I believe only one image of Plagueis with that staff exists, and it's from a Star Wars legend story.
Right.
And not even legend story. Yeah. It's from like an Elseworlds or a could be, and it's just him from the back holding a staff.
So we don't
necessarily
even know if he had a staff in the canon that would exist today. So it's not going to crush any Plagueis dreams for sure if that staff doesn't turn out to be. Now going back to the dialogue, the reason I thought it was the weapon belongs to me because it seems like they're in search for Luke's and Anakin's old lightsaber.
Yeah. And that makes sense.
I think to me that's what he's going after. I think that's what he wants. He's obsessed with Vader. He wants Anakin's original lightsaber here.
Exactly.
So, but
now, I should say too, though, I should mention that what I am not convinced of is that this is Plagueis' staff.
Okay.
You're just saying it's more than just a staff. There's no way I buy that this is just a staff. Now,
I'm not going to disagree all the way.
Might not be. I don't know, but I think. I'm just getting the feeling they're putting so much emphasis on this thing. I gotta believe there's something. Now, the theory you're bringing up though is very interesting. That it becomes the placeholder for another weapon she becomes later. That then makes it believable that she can wield it. I think that's a very interesting theory, and I don't necessarily think you're wrong on that. But even if that's true, I still think there's more significance to this staff.
What I will say though is that it brings up an interesting thing because our own Tiffany Smith had talked about. I had interviewed. She interviewed Daisy Ridley and asked about Darth Plagueis. And when she asked about Darth Plagueis, Daisy Ridley went and just kind of looked and said and shrugged. Now, in that, if you look at those comments, people were like, she just didn't know who she was. Mm. Clearly, that interview says she knows who he is. She's very aware. And if Darth Plagueis at all has not either been maybe mentioned to be in this or whatever, too, it's like, you don't mention him. Mm-hmm. You don't say, oh, some people thought it was Darth Plagueis' staff. You say, yeah, there's been rumors of who it could be. And I'll tell you that the rumors of who it could be, that's not true. It's just the staff. But she mentioned his name. She taught, like, why? That brings us to our next story.
Yes, it does.
Today, Andy Serkis, who happens to be my favorite actor working today, what he does, I think he's just a brilliant, brilliant actor. I was thrilled when I heard that he's going to be part of the new Star Wars trilogy here. This is the interview that they asked, basically, this is some of the words that Andy Serkis said about Snoke. Supreme Leader Snoke is quite an... It's quite a character and strangely vulnerable at the same time as being quite powerful. Obviously, he has a huge agenda. He has suffered a lot of damage. As I said, there is a strange vulnerability to him to which belies his true agenda, I suppose. While Abrams has emphasized the return to practical effects in The Force Awakens, is Snoke perhaps a character who could have been played in circus and makeup? And he says, no. The scale of him, for instance, is one reason. He is large. He appears tall. And also, just the facial design. You couldn't have gotten in there with prosthetics. It's too extreme. Without giving too much away at this point, he has a very distinctive idiosyncratic bone structure and facial structure. You could never have done that in real life. George Lucas was adamant that Darth Plagueis be a species of Immune, yep, which is part of the banking clan. If you're not familiar with that, you should just look up M-U-U-N, I believe it is. Mm-hmm. Look that up. This, to me, seems like Andy Serkis is talking about someone that might be part of the banking clan. Am I crazy?
No. And if you had asked me a month ago, I would have said you were crazy. But over and over again, they've been talking about Plagueis. And as soon as Andy Serkis came out with this explanation and this description of this guy, as soon as he said, what was it, about an asymmetrical face, he's got to be talking about Immune, is what I'm thinking now.
Yeah. John?
I will just go back to my previous comments.
Yeah.
I am almost certain that Snoke is Plagueis. I'm almost certain.
And if you see the progression of this conversation, that carries a lot of weight. Because when I initially, I've been talking about Plagueis possibly being in this movie since the beginning of 2014. And people thought I was nuts.
Justin was one of them.
John Campia was one of them. And John Campia, I think in the beginning of 2014, correct me if I'm wrong, your percentage of Plagueis being in the movie would have been about 3%, maybe 5%. Which is now at what is the percentage you would say?
Oh, a little while ago, I moved it to 97%.
Right. Yes. Justin, what would your percentage be?
I'm going to keep it at a 95.
A 95. I mean, that's... okay, so to let you guys know, this is where we stand on Plagueis. The question is now to you guys out there. Comment below. You saw the title of today's episode. Is Snoke Plagueis? What do you think with these comments from Andy Serkis now? Is this more that adding into it? Or do you think because of what Daisy Ridley just said in the story previous, no, Plagueis is not in this. It's someone brand new. Because even Andy Serkis says in this interview, if you wanted to look it on the other side, no, it's a brand new character. It's a newer character who's just been watching from the sidelines. Now, a newer character could still mean Plagueis because he was only mentioned.
He's never been in the movies. And also keep this in mind. Let's also keep in mind who the director of this film is. It's J.J. Abrams. And let's also keep in mind the last film he directed, which was Star Trek Into Darkness, which he is very famous for adamantly saying, no, Benedict Cumberbatch is not playing Khan.
Right.
Benedict Cumberbatch is not playing Khan. Well, guess what? He was playing Khan. He likes to keep these characters under wraps.
Yeah, he sure was. Okay, so like I said, debate it below. Let's see what you guys say. Now, going to our next topic, we mentioned it briefly when we were looking at the pictures here. Inside of that Entertainment Weekly interview, we found out that Leia is not a princess anymore. She is a general, and she's referred to as a general, says director and co-writer J.J. Abrams, but there's a moment in the movie where the character sort of slips and calls her, where a character sort of slips and calls her princess. So it says mostly no one calls her princess anymore, and that she's really kind of evolved. Like, there's going to be a new side to Leia. What, from just hearing this and seeing that picture and looking like she's like kind of the new Mon Mothma of this franchise, what do you expect to see from Leia? Is she using the Force? Is she nothing of the Force at all? What kind of character do you think Leia is going to be going into this movie?
You know, I'm happy to be here on the show today because I'm a big fan. And one of the discussions of yours that I enjoyed the most was your discussion about the posters. And you mentioned when you were talking about the posters that each of these characters has a unique flavor to them in that poster, and it says something about who that character is. My interpretation is much the same. Those characters all have in those posters their weapon of choice. You've got Han Solo with a blaster. Yeah. You've got Rey with the staff, whoever that belongs to. You've got Finn with the lightsaber. And you have Leia with that beam from the Hoth or the Yavin 4
from
tactical
the strategy
displays.
Board. Yeah,
exactly.
Tactical display.
Her weapon is her mind. And I think that's what you're going to see in this film, great. Is that her weapon is her mind. She is the strategist. She is the Mon Mothma. She is the heart and soul of the Resistance, as she has been the heart and soul of the Rebellion in the previous films. Yeah. And so that's what I think Leia's role is going to be. You might see some Force sensitivity, maybe some hunches that she can play a little bit better than she has in the past, i.e. Empire Strikes Back, I know where Luke is.
Yeah.
But I don't get the feeling that we're really going to see her wield a lightsaber or do what we currently consider, mostly because of the prequel trilogy, Jedi-like things.
I think that's a fantastic. I think you nailed it. And I think one of the things too, if you guys, I would also rave about Knights of the Old Republic. One of the best things to come out of Knights of the Republic, I thought, was Bastila's battle meditation. Mm. That would be something to introduce with Leia, because you can do certain things, like Justin was saying, without just using a lightsaber and doing Force pushes. There's a lot more that Jedi and Sith can do. I mean, if you go back to, even though it's a legend story now, Darth Bane and what Darth Bane was able to do and stuff that he, without spoiling anything, with that smile, he knows what I'm talking about. So there are certain things that Jedi and Sith can do that have not been introduced into the canon in the movies that we know right now that could be. And like Justin's saying with Leia, I would love the fact that her weapon is her mind. That would be incredible. John, what do you expect to see from Leia?
Yeah, that's exactly my perception of the situation, is that she, remember Yoda once said, a Jedi uses the Force for knowledge and defense, never for attack. And right. I think that knowledge is the key thing. I agree with you completely. I don't think when we meet Leia, I mean, we could be totally wrong here, but I don't think when we meet Leia that she has gone off and had a bunch of battles with her lightsaber. And
yeah.
I think she has probably over the years learned to use the Force the way she would use the Force,
right.
which is perception, understanding what's happening, like for knowledge and for all that sort of thing. And you know, you almost look at her in that picture right now and you almost feel her reaching out with the Force a little bit,
yeah.
that sort of thing. So I agree. I don't think we're going to see her pulling out a lightsaber and hacking some fools down or anything like, or that she had ever done that. But I mean, we saw it right in Empire Strikes Back. She's instantly Force sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
She can hear Luke speaking to
right.
her. She knows where to go, all that kind of stuff. That she would leverage that as the leader of what was the Rebellion into the New Republic, into what is whatever is now called the Resistance,
yeah.
only seems to make sense. So I think you're right on about that.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to add, it's worth noting that she, based on what we've seen so far, she recognizes the importance of her Jedi heritage as well.
Yeah.
It's important to note that Maz Kanata, who we think is Maz Kanata, hands that lightsaber over to Leia. There's no other reason that
right.
Leia would be accepting this unless she knew of its significance, and specifically its significance to her. So I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that she is not only using the Force, but she has probably a deeper knowledge than that I think anyone can really guess at as to what the Force is and what the Force is in a time period after the Empire.
Mm.
I think that you are so right there, because if we're all correct and that Kylo Ren is indeed her son.
Oh, yeah.
Right? There's history that she was involved in teaching him. Like you said, I think Maz Kanata is going to have a very strong connection to all the Skywalkers. We'll talk about the international trailer and even how that kind of theory, that theory kind of plays true as well. And even what Han Solo was saying,
yeah.
it's all true. He knows the heritage at this point. The one guy who was saying doesn't believe in the hokey religions, he believes now, right? So obviously, that's because he was married to a Skywalker.
Yeah.
He was married to someone who's very powerful in the Force, and it would be a misstep to not acknowledge Leia being using, you know, like a very different version, like Justin was saying, of the Force here, and seeing what she can do as this leader as well too, because she's a way different leader than Mon Mothma. But I also am very excited because we know that Ackbar is back. Like,
yeah.
I want to see her working with Ackbar now, because he's been around for a very long time. So it's very exciting to hear that her, she's the general. She's the one in control. And I think she's going to have a much bigger role in this and I think she'll stick around. Originally, about a year ago, I thought she was going to, I wouldn't have been surprised if she was going to get taken out early.
Yeah.
My stance has changed tremendously on that. I think she's going to be around for the entire trilogy.
I agree with you. And the whole notion, this whole thing about her not really being called princess anymore, let's, not to be insensitive to the locals and the people who lost anybody on Alderaan, but
yeah.
it's been a while.
Right.
I mean, that's like saying,
30 years, yeah.
I'm the vice president of East Germany.
Right.
I mean, it's not there anymore. So that would kind of make sense that would be a title that probably for the first couple of films, it was still more out of respect and the hair. But I mean, over the years, that would probably be a title that would gradually just fall away.
Now, someone who I don't think is going to make it through the trilogy is one Han Solo. Now, Harrison Ford, the great Harrison Ford, also spoke to Entertainment Weekly, and there was a lot of stuff that he said that was very interesting. Now, this I'd like to also thank StarWarsNewsNet.com, to which we get a lot of our stories, and they've been focusing and they've been featuring Jedi Council Weekly, so thank you to them. And on the article and on the recap that they gave, Harrison Ford repeatedly said that he wished Han Solo had been killed off in Return of the Jedi to give the final film in the original trilogy emotional gravity. He told NBC's Today back then, "I was glad to see that costume for the last time." 73-year-old star has softened significantly now that the planet is besides itself waiting the return of Star Wars The Force Awakens. "I was glad that the character was still alive for me to play this new iteration." Ford does play favorites when it comes to his two most, like, he talks about Han Solo and Indiana Jones, and he talked about going back and like to play Indiana Jones. But something that I thought was pretty awesome is he asked if he watched the Force Awakens trailer debut with the rest of the world during halftime on Monday Night Football. He answers, "I was trying to watch the damn football game." Only grudgingly, does he admit that everything stopped for a moment at his home with his wife and their son when it aired. "But just for a moment, we were in the middle of preparing dinner and doing homework," and he shrugs, "just watching it over our shoulder." He said, "There's no abandoning of the character." He said, "He's the same guy that he was, just an older version of him." And then the last question they asked about the anthology film, they asked him, "Have they talked to you about their young Han Solo film?" And he said, "I think they're probably talking to the young Han Solo."
great line.
It was a great line. And hearing, like, he even the watching, I think we talked about him last week when he was on Jimmy Kimmel. He's got a brand new excitement about Star Wars. That should be very encouraging to fans. And it's not just a guy that's just like, "Oh, I'm going to be in the biggest movie ever." Yeah. It's Harrison Ford.
He's been there and done that a few times.
He's been there, and he doesn't have to be, and he could go back to, and he's going to do an Indiana Jones, and yeah, he'll do Blade Runner, and he's doing this thing that, like, say, Stallone did, and even what Arnold did, and these guys going back to their old franchises. But they didn't have, Stallone and Schwarzenegger didn't have Star Wars. They didn't have a character like Han Solo, who's one of the most iconic guys of all time, and we get to see him do it again. I believe even from that line that he delivers in that trailer, he's back, baby. Like, he is back. I still don't think he's making it out of 7. That's me. John, you hear these comments, everything you hear from Han Solo himself, what do you think?
Oh, it only reinforces to me, personally, it only reinforces to me what I already know. You're going to see Han Solo in Episode 8. 9, don't know.
Okay.
But by the end of 9, don't know. But you're going to see him, even at the end of 8, I don't know. But you're going to see him in 8. It's great because he has proven, and we've talked a little bit about this before, Harrison Ford has proven, I've sat down and talked with him several times, he has proven he does not feel the need. He is Harrison Ford, and he knows it. And he feels he is at that level in his career where he is afforded the privilege of, "I don't have to say things I don't want to say." I've sat down with him and talked about movies that he's in where maybe he won't come out and crap talk his own movie that he's been in, but he has never once lied to my face. Like, I remember I talked to him about that movie he did with Liam Hemsworth called Paranoia, which was an awful movie, just an awful movie. And at the time I was with AMC Theaters, so I'm trying to get these actors to say, to pitch the movie, to sell the movie, right? And I just couldn't get him to do it. And what he would do is says, "I really enjoyed working with Gary Oldman again," and which was true because his scenes in that movie with Gary Oldman were actually quite good.
Yeah.
But he never once said anything to pump that movie that you could tell he didn't actually think. And now, with that in mind, keeping that in context, that's who this guy is, to hear him come out and so actively promote this film, so energetically be enthusiastic about the film, to shamelessly sell this film, it can be nothing but big, bright green lights for all of us who are fans, which also is part of the reason why I'm sure now he doesn't mind coming back for 8. But I mean, it can be nothing but good, because this is not your typical Hollywood actor who is just going to say, "I love working with this crew." And this, that's not Harrison
Ford. And he doesn't
Ford.
Have to sell the movie.
He doesn't
know,
and he doesn't
itself.
Have to.
Yeah, Justin.
No. When you're right, you're right. I think that you are right about Han Solo not dying in this movie. I think there's someone else who might die in this movie who a lot of people aren't suspecting will die in this movie, and I think that's Finn. As far as
I've been
Harrison,
starting to suspect that myself,
I've got a whole conspiracy theory going about Finn right now. But as far as Harrison Ford, I think that it's twofold. One, and I don't know, this might be a result of the plane accident, or it might just be the result of, again, the mileage. I think he's thinking about legacy. And you can hear it when he's talking about these roles. Mm. I don't think it's just that it's Star Wars. I don't think that it's just he's Han Solo again. I think he understands the significance of this particular role on his career, in that storied career that you're talking about right now, that allowed him to be Harrison Ford, and not just him, but everybody knows it. And I think that, I think back to Hall H at Comic-Con this year, when he stepped out on stage, when he stepped out on stage later that night at that concert at Comic-Con, Harrison Ford, who is the quintessential grumpy old man of stars, had this grin on his face that I can't ever remember seeing him having when he's doing press for a movie, when he's doing appearances or anything like that.
And he had the same grin at D23 also.
He did. And it's something that you're seeing continuously from him as he promotes this movie and any time that he talks about this movie. And again, I can't remember the last time, if any, I've ever seen him look that way. So I don't think he's dying in this film. I agree he's coming back for at least episode 8, and I think he's happy about that. And that's part of what you're seeing is he's talking and making the rounds.
Yeah, the D23 thing is a great example. Yeah. He came out on that stage.
Oh, he was taken back.
And
taken
I'm telling you, he looked 55 again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, he came out on that stage, he glowed when he came out on that stage, and he was happy. Very, very different Harrison Ford than when I talked, than when he was promoting Cowboys and Aliens.
Right. Why am I here?
Well, you know, the movie business is the movie business. You know, it's like, different guy.
It's true. Now, look, moving on to our next story here is that some people may be excited about this. Some people would say, no, we don't need any more. Apparently, ABC is going to do a special look tonight of The Force Awakens, Thursday at 8 p.m. Central Time. We're going to have a brand new kind of special look of The Force Awakens. Now, I don't know what this entails. Is it going to be another teaser? Is it going to be a little special feature type thing that they did? I don't necessarily know. Of course, I'm going to watch it. I don't know. I don't think that we need it anymore. I mean, we're about a month away. But, Justin, what do you think we're going to see in this Force Awakens little preview?
Well, first of all, I mean, I think when anyone thinks of Shonda Rhimes, Scandal, you know, any of her shows, you think Star Wars instantly. So it's a natural fit. as far as what we're...
Grey's Anatomy, I mean, it's basically
the
Empire.
It's the same thing. As far as what we're going to see tonight, I think for diehards who are following the marketing, we're not going to see a lot of new stuff. I think for general audiences who I'm so happy that Lucasfilm and Disney continuously is making overtures towards, because they realize what they have, but they realize that not everyone necessarily realizes what they have. Mm. I think it's more of the same. I think we might get a few new shots similar to what we've seen this week and last week. But by and large, I think it's going to be something that we're already used to. But other people, I mean, again, Shondaland isn't necessarily the first in line to see The Force Awakens, if you really think about it. Why not use this to highlight an angle that might draw them in? If we're right about all the family politics, I mean, that, and seriously, is kind of a built-in story there that I can see a lot of viewers who are interested in those kinds of shows wanting to find out a little bit more about.
So you'd be crafted, you think that whatever we see, it'll be crafted more into that family element, similar to the international trailer, which we'll talk about soon.
Yeah, but I think
by
in
family,
a different
we're talking family drama, not family as in friendly for 10-year-olds.
No, exactly. The lineage and all that stuff. But John, so what do you think we're going to see tonight?
I want to hope you're right. But that being said, you know, once they put out the full trailer, right, with that Monday Night Football game, which was also not what you would think would be the target audience for Star Wars thing, but ultimately that's what made it brilliant.
And it
did
all right.
And it performed okay. But then we hear that an international trailer is coming. Generally speaking, not always, but generally speaking, when an international trailer drops after a main trailer, it's essentially the same trailer with a few little tweaks here and there to maybe appeal a little bit different to the international audience. This international version of the trailer was not an international. It was a totally new trailer. Then when the first TV spot comes after a major trailer, it's usually just a condensed version, about a 30-second version of that. That was not the case. It was 30 brand new seconds of stuff that essentially we hadn't seen before. This all leaves me very nervous that once we get into, as you so greatly coined it, Shondaland tonight, that they're going to show us another 45 seconds or another minute. And I'll be honest, I don't want to see any more. And
you're
if
gonna
they
watch
do,
it, though.
Of course I am, because I'm an idiot. Of course I'm gonna watch it. And I think you're absolutely right. I think when they do show it, it will be new stuff, and it will be new stuff highlighting the family drama aspect that will appeal to those people. Like with the Monday Night Football thing, lots of X-Wings, lots of TIE fighters, lots of explosions. And now here, you're going to see Kylo grabbing Daisy and saying, I am your brother. Or something. You're going to see some kind of family drama going. I don't really think you're going to see that scene, but something family.
I think that you're right. I think we're going to get new footage. I think it's going to be, because for that reason alone, that it's ABC. There's a way for, they saw
owned
what
by
happened.
Disney.
Owned by Disney, and they saw what happened with Monday Night Football. They saw that how the rabid fan base went there, even though it's the fans, you know, the fans that maybe they're gearing towards the fans who haven't seen that stuff, but the ones who have are going to go there and go, oh, come on, I want to see new stuff. As opposed, now when that fan base, that's who you got to target. You got to go after us.
And here's the other thing about when they show footage tonight, I absolutely guarantee, especially since it's Shondaland, right? It is going to be a Rey heavy piece of footage.
Yeah.
They are going to be appealing to the female audience.
Absolutely.
Which, if they have any deficiency in their audience demographic, it's probably a little bit more guys than girls, so they're going to be targeting the women in this.
I think that's a fantastic point, because it's to let people know more, because even, again, my wife, who's like, well, Star Wars is for guys. And that's, and because she's not a big Star Wars fan, but when you're watching, if you're watching the show and then you see it, oh, wait, because my wife, again, when we saw the latest trailer, the International, she's like, oh, so she's really, she's like, this is the role of a lifetime for this girl. She's like the main character. Now she knows that you're right.
Look at the IMAX poster. It says
I think
it
it's
all,
a
right?
brilliant, I think it's a brilliant marketing tool to do that. And I still think that you can show, but I will say, and we'll get into it here in a second, though, I don't think that a lot has been spoiled yet. I agree. I know that a lot of people have been complaining there's too much being shown, because I think that that's because we're almost there. Because rewind.
We're so freaking close.
Rewind 2 months
so
ago.
Close.
2 months ago, everyone's going, well, come on, we haven't seen anything. Where is it? Now everyone's going, no, come on, no more. And that leads us into our next story. It was Friday, out of nowhere. Like, the difference is the trailer that we got on Monday Night Football, we knew it was coming.
Oh, look at that.
This thing drops on Friday morning. No one saw this thing coming. Nobody was talking about it. You didn't know. It just, oh, yeah, by the way, did you see this? I'm like, and like you said, John, it's probably the same thing with a couple new shots. And then there's a whole new narrative. It's like this whole, and then that's the shot you see in the thumbnail, and you're like, well, yeah, I'm going to push play. And then you watch it, and you see more of, and you see those shots, the TIE fighter shots, what the discussion about the family is. It's like, I know all about waiting, you know, waiting for my family. Now, some people could say, well, she's like Ezra. She's been dropped off, and Ezra from Rebels, who was also kind of a loner, and Luke also a loner. That's the thing that the International trailer did for me. This was a straight up parallel to Luke Skywalker.
Yes, it was.
And for me, I have been saying it, I stick by it, and we'll talk about it at the end of the show as well too. This is Luke Skywalker's daughter. That is my statement on it. Justin, what do you think?
Not Luke Skywalker's daughter. No way.
All right.
But I had to pull over in morning traffic to watch this thing because I had no idea it was coming. I would have called in. I would have gone in late. I would have done something to be there when I knew it was coming out. But I mean, all of a sudden, I see this amazing shot for a diehard Imperial fan like myself of these TIE fighters coming towards them with that sun in the background.
Man.
And, oh, man. Like, I lost it.
Yeah.
I totally lost it and watched it again twice before getting back on the road. But you're right about the narrative. It's been very interesting, and this feeds into my Finn isn't going to make it conspiracy theory, to notice the shift in the narrative from Star Wars is coming back to here are the new characters to let's talk about Rey and let's focus on her, and then have a poster come out that emphasizes just her for the biggest format that we're going to put this film out in. And I think that's the biggest gift, as you said, that this trailer gave us, is it's about Rey. It's about Rey. I do think it's worth noting that the For My Family line seems like it might be a little clipped. She says, I know all about waiting. And then
you
there's
mentioned that too.
Yeah.
There's a different pitch. There's a different sound
like
to For
together,
My Family.
Right.
Yeah. So the only thing I would say about that to warn fans is be cognizant of the fact that movie marketers want to market to you and get you to put your butt in the seat.
Right.
And sometimes to do that, they're going to splice together things that may hint at something different so that you're not expecting what really is going to happen when you sit down.
Sure.
But I love that stuff because it ties right back into the mystery of everything without necessarily withholding things. And that's where a lot of the people who you were talking about were frustrated at the beginning.
John?
I think one thing, though, to keep in mind, too, I think, remember, it would have been the easiest thing in the world if they wanted to have that line, and let's say misdirection. If they wanted to use that line as a misdirection, would have been the easiest thing in the world. Say, Daisy, we need you to come into this studio for 10 minutes.
Right.
And just record the line saying it. I know a lot about waiting for my family. Just say it like that, and we'll just drop that in the trailer. But instead, they didn't feel the need to do that, so they spliced some things together. That's what lends me to believe it's not necessarily a misdirection. Because if they wanted to misdirect, they could have done it a lot easier by just getting her in, record the line, and be done with it. Because we know other trailers have done that. Put lines and things like that in trailers that aren't even in the movie, right?
Yeah.
But you're looking at the offspring of Han and Leia. I believe you're looking at both of them.
I
think you're looking at the offspring of Han and Leia. I don't think Luke ever had a child. I think we're going to get to that point. But I'm not going to say absolutely not.
No,
I believe there is a possibility one of these two is a Luke child. But if I got to put my money on one, I'm saying that these two are both. They are siblings. They are Han and Leia's
kids. It's not a crazy thing to...
It's not a crazy idea.
No, for you, what you're saying, because look... When this was first announced, I was saying this is Jason and Jaina Solo, which is from the expanded universe and Timothy Zahn's great novels. I thought this is going to happen, and there was a thing that came out a long time ago that Michael Arndt, this was the story he was going to write. It was about the Solo twins. It was about the twins. So if it turns out that that's part of it, and there's also, I forget the name of the comic, and you might know as well too, that a lot of people saying there's a lot of similarities to the Force Awakens story.
Legacy.
And this to me is, I would not be surprised if it turns out that these are the Solo twins. I just have a feeling in my gut. The same way I had a feeling when I saw that poster when I said, that's Maz Kanata, that little thing. It's Maz Kanata. So I'm just saying. When the Force speaks to me sometimes, I listen and I say it. So I'm hoping there's going to be tons of things that I'm wrong about. I just happen to think, for me, cousins could also have the same kind of impact.
Okay, they'd both be Skywalkers.
And
now here's the other thing that maybe goes towards your theory, okay? Even though I do believe they're siblings, they're Han and Leia's. But one of the other things that goes towards your theory, that maybe one is a Luke child, one is a Princess Leia's child, is that we know that Lucasfilm and the creators of all the new films are free, even though Legends Now, the extended universe, is non-canon. Right. It doesn't really exist. They have said many times they are free to go in and pick story elements from those and bring them in. And when talking about Skywalker children, we always just default to the twins. Well, okay, we all know about twins. Don't forget, there were two other Skywalker children.
True.
There was Ben and Anakin. Yeah. And one of them was Luke's child.
Right.
And Anakin was the third child of Han and Leia. So while we are sitting here, maybe they're picking from the extended universe, the Legends universe, to bring in these siblings. Maybe they are dipping into the extended universe. But maybe it's not the twins they're dipping into. Maybe it's other Skywalker children. So I still believe they are siblings.
Yeah.
But what you're suggesting, there is valid reason to believe why you believe.
I just think you'd have to right away say, oh, hey, Dad, when Han Solo pops up and is there with Rey, unless she doesn't know that she's a Solo kid, and then it comes out to be revealed later on.
I don't want to show that in the trailer yet either.
I know, I know, but I'm just saying, well, once it starts, so you've got to have that element. Like, that's my dad, and you're giving away that reveal
but
quick.
But I think part of that conversation, honestly, I think part of that conversation is the conversation that ends with, it's true, all of it. I think that conversation about, you're my father, it's true, all of it.
Certainly possible, but I also think there's a much bigger reveal for
that's
a story
too.
At the very end if... What it looks like to where Kylo Ren sees them in that forest and they're fighting, and it doesn't look like Finn does very well in that fight. And then, like you said, Luke comes in, pops in, and goes, well, I'm not just going to let my daughter.
I have mentioned I'm going to defecate myself when Luke pops up, right?
Everyone will.
In the middle of the fight. In
that
the middle
theater's
the
going to smell terrible because everyone in the whole theater.
Dennis has seats next to me, and we're already booked in the theater. You're sitting next to me.
It's going
to
be rough. So, I mean,
bring a change.
And then the same week, by the way, or the same, I think like the day after, or maybe even the day of, the TV spot dropped.
Yeah.
And that furthers into this conversation was that you have Maz Kanata, who is now really narrating this thing with, I've seen those eyes before. I love where this character and who this character is. Like you guys were saying before, she's been around. She knows Luke. She knows Leia. She knows this family. She knows history. Certainly seems to know the history because it looks like they're walking into her castle when Han and Finn and Rey, and you get the Mandalorian flag, the Anakin flag, the Sebulba flag. There's all this history.
Broken horns,
yeah. There's all this history there, and she knows it. I'm fascinated, and it also to me that shot, I think, and I've said this a few times, of when we don't know that hooded figure who's touching R2, I'm convinced that is Luke in flashback. Yeah. I think that's going to be
I thought that too, but remember, then JJ said that one thing. There's a reason you haven't seen Luke in this stuff yet. So, once again, it's JJ Abrams. He could be lying through his teeth, but that's the one thing, maybe, because I thought at first, the very first time we saw that in the very first trailer,
right,
they had that shot, and I remember thinking, oh, that must be Luke. And then I started thinking, maybe it's not Luke, and then we heard JJ say, there's a reason you haven't seen Luke yet in these trailers, so.
What do you think of this TV spot?
Man, it's a loaded question. Yeah. First of all, as far as flashbacks possibly, it's worth noting that at Comic-Con 2014, Pablo Hidalgo from the Lucasfilm Story Group also made a specific point of saying that flashbacks are not a part of how Star Wars tells a story.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that we can't see a flash forward or a vision of the future. There are shots in these trailers that could be possible things that could happen. What is
allusions
it
to Episode 8 or allusions to Episode 9? Right.
Or even allusions to what could happen if the characters in this film don't take action.
Right.
And because of these, they know what actions to take.
And when did Pablo say that, in 2014?
At the Rebels panel at Comic-Con in San Diego in 2014, he said.
Had they started shooting The Force Awakens yet?
They had.
Okay.
The reason I bring that up is because it was right around that time that flashbacks, actually, that was around the time that Indie Revolver broke those, the hand is in space.
You know,
floating around and stuff like that. And there were a lot of mentions of possible flashbacks. So I have always personally interpreted that as he knows what's going on on social media and the fan world, and maybe he needed to address that.
Right.
Could be wrong.
Right.
But it's possible Maz Kanata could be showing them things that are happening around the galaxy. It's also worth noting that for fans of older Star Wars, you mentioned Knights of the Old Republic before.
Right.
Maz Kanata is a great storytelling device to take us back to those times if she's 1,000 years old, which I think came out this week.
Oh, really?
You can pull Saving Private Ryan, close in on those eyes, open back someplace else, and now you've got Star Wars stories or anthology films that happen before everything that we're showing right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's going to be very interesting to see. I think that the legacy and this, just the story and the family history again and told through Maz Kanata's eyes. Okay, moving on now. This is a story that could be sad for a lot of people, and it also can make sense for a lot of people. This dropped this week, is that the great Lawrence Kasdan, who's going to be, he wrote The Force Awakens. He obviously wrote Jedi and Empire Strikes Back, and he'll also be writing the Han Solo anthology film. Hollywood Reporter had an interview that said that Kazdan says, I've now made 4 Star Wars movies. That's more than enough. He added that he had little interest in being involved in the Solo movie, but that his family were so excited about the idea for him, he agreed to co-write the screenplay with his son, John Kazdan. So this looks like, from everything that this is saying here, that Kazdan's done with Star Wars after Han Solo. Is this a horrible thing? Does this make sense? John, what do you think?
No, it's a good thing.
Yeah.
It's a good thing for him. This is a best of both worlds situation. Like, I've said this before about, like, Oscar hosts, right? When you have a train wreck of an Oscars, with Anne Hathaway and James Franco, go to something that you know works and is reliable and is rock steady. And what do? They went back to Billy Crystal.
Right.
Steady the ship. And that's what they did here. Like, when you have the franchise still reeling a bit from the prequels and things like that, what do? Go get Lawrence Kasdan. Look, in the television world, right, what they'll often do is they'll get a great director in for that first pilot episode. Why? Because that pilot episode sets the tone and direction for the rest of the series that all the other directors will follow. To bring in Lawrence Kasdan to do The Force Awakens with J.J. And remember, they had an Academy Award-winning writer on before that. I'm forgetting his name.
Empire?
Episode 7.
Michael Arndt.
Michael Arndt, thank you, as well. And so then you bring in Kasdan, and JJ's working on it. So what you've done now is you got the guy who is so proven in Star Wars to now come in with JJ to set that tone for this brand new trilogy of films, this brand new set of films, however many it's going to be. And then you let him take a break, man.
Right. Yeah,
I mean, you say, oh my God, you're still going to do Solo for us? Thank you so much.
Right.
And then pat him on the back, man, and say, dude, well done. And now you still got Kennedy there. You still have JJ as a producer. You've got some magnificent directors involved now, especially with Rian Johnson and stuff like that are now all in this Star Wars sandbox. I think he's going to set them on the right path. He'll step back and let them run with it. Yeah. I think it's really good for him.
Justin?
Yeah. Once again, you're right. But I think beyond just getting somebody to write the ship and somebody to reestablish what Star Wars is to the wider audience that made it a success in the first place,
right.
You get the new blood in after that.
Yes.
Everything is going to be left in a good place if everything that we're seeing is an indicator. And after that's done, bring in somebody else. Bring in people to play in the sandbox in the same way that you're getting directors who grew up loving this stuff in J.J. Abrams and Rian Johnson and Colin Trevorrow. Get writers of that caliber to come in and still play around with it, to take it to new places, to bring in some fresh blood and new ideas. And because we're building 21st century Star Wars on such a strong base,
right.
I mean, it's nothing but good things.
I agree, and I think that that's the thing, is the fact that it's not like they're going to call him afterwards and he's going to go, "Nah, I told you, don't call me anymore." It's like, he's there. He's there for you. He's going to be there. He has been there for you. J.J. Abrams and him have also, I will also say this. I don't believe that this is J.J. Abrams' last Star Wars film either. Now, I think that whether or not, how phenomenal would it be to hear that J.J. Abrams is going to do an anthology film? You'd be thrilled if that happens. Now, I think
let me see episode 7 first before I decide if I'd be thrilled to hear that or not.
I think you're going to be thrilled.
I think I'm going to be thrilled
from what you've seen so far and the way that he's been putting it together. Yeah. I think that, but I'm just saying that, like, there's these relationships, and Kazdan's always been very collaborative in the Star Wars world, and it was a crucial element of why the original trilogy is what it is. So I agree with you guys, though, too. I think that it's good to see what Star Wars has meant for so many people over the years. When he joined the team, it was a lot smaller of a creative unit. And now there's all these people that Star Wars means so much to people, that these new, like a Gary Whitta and guys that people that come in here that can write Star Wars. There are people, look what the team just of Rebels has done. Rebels is able to continue what Kazdan and look what Kinberg has done. Like there are many writers out there. There are many directors out there that can continue the legacy of what Kazdan has done. I agree. You give the guy a break.
Yeah, and I'll say this one last thing too about Kazdan. If episode 7 is what we hope it is.
Right.
Even if it just comes close to what we hope it is, and if it's a great movie, returns us to Star Wars, all that kind of stuff, if that happens, then forever and always, the first name in Star Wars will always be George Lucas, absolutely, bar none, nothing will ever change that. But I'm going to propose that if Episode 7 is a great movie, then I think right after George, whenever we say Star Wars, we got to talk about Lawrence Kasdan.
Oh, yeah.
I think he's the next name that we're going to... If he can return this franchise, all due respect to J.J. as well, obviously, too, but with what he did with Empire, and now brings it back into glory, he's got to be up there with George Lucas.
There's one guy I'd put him over him.
Filoni?
Bob Iger. Bob Iger to me...
But Iger wasn't there for Empire and Jedi.
No, he wasn't.
All that kind of
no,
stuff,
he wasn't.
You know?
But as far as bringing it back, I am... such a fan of Bob Iger because he's one of these rare guys who's a corporate guy.
Mm-hmm.
He gets it, man.
Oh, Iger like, is so smart.
I mean, his vision, he could have easily been that guy that goes, "I'm going to buy Star Wars and then we know what the fans want," when they don't know what the fans want. I was like, no, let me find out what Kathleen Kennedy thinks the fans want. And then go get the right guys. Go get the right people. What do you guys want to do with your property? We just want to bring it into the family.
And then Kennedy, too. I mean, Kennedy was handpicked by Lucas.
It's that team, man. All of them deserve to be in the conversation, for sure. Okay, so that's that. And then the last story here today, and John, I think, touched on this beautifully on Movie Talk the other day. We lost a great Star Wars fan. We were talking about Daniel Fleetwood last week on the show. John talked about him. He passed away a couple days ago, and it was a story that really touched all of us as Star Wars fans, as human beings in general. The fact that this guy was such a big Star Wars fan as we were, and that he was able, and that Lucasfilm and Disney and JJ, they were all able to fulfill his dream and let him watch Star Wars, and he was able to do it, and the support that his wife not only gave him but received from the community. It was a beautiful, touching, and sad story all in one. We wish nothing but the best for his family, who will remember him greatly. We're sorry that we lost him, but we are also grateful for the community out there. We are grateful for Disney and JJ for what they have done. So that's just my thoughts on it. It was really nice to see. But I don't know if you guys have anything else to share on that.
I would just add that covering this stuff, talking about this stuff all the time, social media, you're online, it's the web, things can sometimes get a little vitriolic. People who want to complain about things, people who want to say that Star Wars is dead. What an amazing story to show you how much the story itself of Star Wars means to people. And yeah. I love that it's just positive. It puts so much in perspective that I feel has sometimes been lost on the ride towards episode seven.
John, I know that you spoke really well and eloquently the other day on Movie Talk, but have you anything of what this has kind of meant for the Star Wars community and Daniel's family?
Well, you know, just to sum up briefly what I said on Movie Talk the other day is that it admits the tragedy and awful. It is a story of incredible... it's an incredibly uplifting story at the same time that reinvests your belief in humanity because, you know, you had a world of Star Wars fans who never knew this guy, had nothing to gain from it, no connection to him whatsoever, yet giving voice to and fighting for and trying to get his last dream fulfilled. And in this world that we all live in, like whether it's, you know, covering technology, covering movies, covering skateboarding, covering whatever it is you cover, the online world is filled with a lot of trolls and a lot of assholes and a lot of just a lot of things that make us lose faith in humanity. Daniel brought out the best in us. Daniel's wife brought out the best in us, and it was a great story to just kind of revive that belief in humanity. And in the midst of incredible sadness, this family, the online Star Wars family, Disney, J.J. Abrams, Kathleen Kennedy, the Star Wars world, made something beautiful out of it. And it was just an incredible thing to witness.
Well said. Okay, so that now moving forward onto our next, that's all the movie news that we wanted to talk about. The next section of the show, if you're brand new to us, it is simply called What's the Deal with Canon? Everything happening in the world of Star Wars. It could be the books or the comic books or the video games or TV shows that ultimately tie into the history of the Star Wars universe, the movies. And there's a lot of stuff happening in the world of canon. The first one is that, you know, if you follow us here on Collider, you will know that myself and John and David Griffin, we all do a Rebels recap. Every Wednesday after the show comes out, we talk about the latest episodes. Now, the most recent one was episode 5. It was called Wings of the Master.
Yep.
And this episode just aired last night. Justin, are you a big fan of Rebels? First, okay, you are. And so did you see last night's episode? If so, what did you think?
I loved it. I wish that it had had more time to really breathe. I felt like that story had so many amazing beats to it and so many great moments. And it didn't necessarily hurt the quality of the episode that it didn't go past one.
Right.
But I do feel that Rebels is getting towards the same point that the Clone Wars did at one time, which is maybe it's time to start telling stories in arcs rather than just one story. There was one moment in particular where Hera is talking about her love of flight and relating, you know, it to parts of her past and her family that was really inspirational. But when you watch that episode, it just felt really pushed in there. Like, this is where we want to explain to you that Hera is in love with flying. And something about it didn't quite flow the right way to me. I loved the story. I loved the acting. The animation behind that moment was great. It just seemed very quick.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I can see that as well, too. But I think because we're having a longer season, I think that I'd be more on that side of it if we were at about 10 to 12 episodes like we were last season. But because we're getting about 22, I think you're going to see those arcs that you're talking about, too. And I think that we're going to see the longer episodes, especially, you know, the mid-season. I think we get an hour. The finale, we get an hour, 45 minutes, whatever it is. But I think you're going to see those arcs. And like Filoni had said in the press conference, all these characters are going to get serious.
Yeah.
Character development, and I think that will be, we just got to get us into the tone again like they're doing, and I think we're going to pick up. But I did, you know, if you want to see more of our thoughts, John, do you have anything to add before we...
Well, my thoughts were shared on the recap show, so go on over and watch them there. But you remember, what was my one complaint?
It was too rushed, too fast.
But not just this episode. Yeah, I feel like, and maybe that just speaks to how much I like the show, is that like this season, the shows feel really fast.
Right.
And maybe they should just say, screw it. Let's make Rebels an hour-long show instead of a half-hour show. Think about that, Filoni, for next
year.
It'll
be tough. But if you guys want to go check out our Rebel recap, it's every Wednesday. The most recent one is up right now. If you're caught up with the season, go and check it out. We do it every week. It's myself, like I said, John, and David Griffin. Okay, next story. There is an update here on the theme park. It is a glimpse at the Star Tours Jakku sequence and more. Disney recently unveiled a few more important bits of information about the future presence of Star Wars at their theme parks. Most excitingly, they include a rough cut of a brand new clip that will be used for the Jakku experience to the Star Tours attraction. Once the Jakku scene is implemented to the ride, it will be shown with every instance of the Star Tours for the first few months. Afterward, its appearance will be randomized. Other things that were revealed with Disney's press release include the following. December 1st is the date that the new Star Wars attractions will start opening at Disney World. Star Wars Launch Bay will open with a behind-the-scene look at the making of the films, including the chance to meet Darth Vader and Chewbacca. Star Wars Weekends will indefinitely be canceled with no promises to return until after Star Wars Land is opened. The Star Wars Path of the Jedi feature will include clips throughout the saga to familiarize newcomers with the franchise. And Jedi Training, Trials of the Temple will now feature the Seventh Sister in addition to Darth Vader. All right, so you hear these things. Justin, what out of those things that was announced are you most excited about?
Definitely Star Tours. Huge fan of that ride. Yeah. Ride it again and again. Thankfully, I have not been the Rebel Spy yet. Again, I like the Empire. But yeah, the Jakku sequence, and even the fact that they released those, 10 seconds we said?
Yeah.
I don't remember the last time that we've seen a sequence from Star Tours released previously.
No, I don't think it's ever happened yet.
That was pretty big and very exciting, and I can't wait to ride it.
Yeah, I think to me what it says is that obviously Jakku, even though I think it's going to be the major part of the beginning, I think that, you know, I don't know how much more it'll play in The Force Awakens except very prominent in the beginning.
Yeah.
It is still going to be prominent. I think that Jakku is going to be very important in the storytelling, and obviously that's why they're showing it, that's why they're putting it in Battlefront. But I also, and to also echo our friends again over at StarWarsNewsNet.com, they said that for them, then the same thing for me, is the Seventh Sister's presence at the park, and what they're referencing is how long it suggests she's going to be on Rebels and how much she's going to be a part of
Spoiler,
this
series. Spoiler, it does look, she's not going to be around for 3 episodes and then gone. So, but who
knows how long? Who knows what she's going to serve? I know that originally when Sarah Michelle Gellar was announced to be on this show, a lot of people, including myself, thought, oh, maybe that's the Mara Jade type character from the Timothy Zahn novels. That could still be possible. Who knows? So maybe eventually down the line you guys are saying, well, how could Luke have it? Oh, wait a minute. Maybe that's how he has a daughter. But yeah, John, so out of those things, anything that stands out to you?
Well, I mean, super stoked about the ride.
Right.
The idea, for those of you who don't know, how many sequences are there? Like 19 or 18 sequences for the ride, then they're randomized every time. Right. So basically you get a different, there's like 500 possible combinations. I don't know what the actual number is. There's tons of different combinations. The concept that they will make sure for the first few months that Jakku one will be in every single ride, no matter what. I think that's going to bring a lot of people out to it. That's great. A lot of it is just background noise to me, though, and I just want Star Wars Land.
Yeah.
I just want Star Wars Land. Yeah, just get me to Star Wars Land.
But this
Land,
is what
please.
They're doing. It's going to take you a while to
it's
get
gonna
there.
It's going to take a while
it's
to build
a long
it.
Time
yeah.
to build. Okay. Next, moving on here, there was a new Battlefront live action trailer that came out. I think that their campaign has been great. Anna Kendrick was in this one as well, too. There's just something about it. Like when you see this particular trailer and the jumping into the actual game and people getting excited for it, it's the perfect timing for where we are as far as the release of the movie. But it's just that music. The music pops in, and I'm there. I'm already into it, and I love the trailer. But Justin, how'd you like the trailer?
I'm so stoked for Battlefront. Yeah. You have no idea. I liked this trailer. Yeah. I'm not gonna lie; it was a little weird to me.
Was it with
the clothes disappearing at first? You didn't know if these people were being raptured or if you know.
You didn't get the Obi-Wan reference?
I did, but at the same time, when it happens to so many people, when it happens to Obi-Wan, it's special. Darth Vader cuts through and the clothes.
Okay,
are there.
Good point.
But you know, once you see them res into Battlefront, then you forget everything else. It clicks in a way that I don't think it clicked for me at first. And then, like you said, you're right back there. You're excited for Battlefront. Right. You're ready to do it.
John?
Not a good commercial.
No, you didn't like it?
In like the first 5 seconds,
okay.
I got the Obi-Wan reference. At 6 seconds, I still got the Obi-Wan reference. At the 17-second mark, I still got the Obi-Wan. At the 20-second mark, I still got the Obi-Wan reference.
Right.
Move on! It was poorly constructed as a commercial. You could have had 5 seconds of that and then moved into the... Once you got to Anna Kendrick, and then they move into the Battlefront footage...
That was it.
Then it's great. But they killed the commercial with like... Okay, yes, we get it. It's an Obi-Wan 4. They're going into the game. We get it. And then they just kept going and going, and they lost me. So it could have been a great commercial. I ended up not ever looking to watch it again.
Okay, fair enough. Moving on here. So one person that we haven't seen or heard from at all is Max von Sydow. Now, in this, there's a book that's going to come out. It's like a young reader book, Finn and the First Order. And inside this picture there, that looks like the first reveal that we really get of Max von Sydow's character. And it looks like he's talking to Poe. It looks like BB-8 is there. It looks like this might be Jakku because you see the stormtrooper on the side there. It very well could be the beginning. Before we even, I wouldn't be surprised now, by the way, if this movie opens up with Poe. He's the first person you see, and some kind of dealings are happening on Jakku, and that could be a scene out of it. But this is the first that we see of him. I know that at one point I bought into it's old Boba Fett. I don't really buy into that anymore. You and I have very different, we have a different opinion here. Like, there is a book called Aftermath. There's a character in Aftermath called Sinjir. I'm pretty much convinced that he is this character Sinjir because there is a passage in Aftermath that says keeps referring to him as the tall man. Max von Sydow is 6'5". He's a tall man. I wonder why they had to that Chuck Wendig had to do that and why he had to reference that. That's my taking on it. But John, you see this picture of Max von Sydow. Are you shocked that this is kind of the first look that we're getting at him through this picture? And who do you think he's going to be?
Well, let's be clear. There's nothing actually saying that's Max von Sydow. True. I mean, it could be another old character.
You're right.
Obviously, it makes sense, though. That does make sense.
Yes.
But there's nothing. Let's just be clear that there is nothing saying that this is Max von Sydow. If it is indeed our first look at him, then it is surprising that this is our first look at him. But then again, look, they've been handling this marketing so well that if they feel like this is the best way to do it, I'm at the point now that I'll give them the benefit of the doubt. And unless seeing this picture when I go into the movie, somehow that ruins something for me in the movie, which I can't see how that would be the case.
Right.
I'll go with it, sure.
Okay, Justin?
Not really a dog in the fight. Could be Max von Sydow, could not be. I think it's not Sinjir, personally. I think he has a destiny that is separate from the films, but we'll see. I do think it's kind of a funny illustration to sit there and look at, though.
Yeah. What are they talking about?
Yeah. It's like, what? BB-8 kind of peeking out over the side, like, I'm here, too.
Yeah, you know where I can get some good pizza around here? Okay, so that's it in regards to that particular book and picture. Now we're going to get into a little bit of the reviews. Now, we talk about everything here. There's a couple of comics that came out this week. One of those would be Vader, number 12. I have read this one. I believe Justin has. John, you haven't had a chance to read this one, right?
No.
You're waiting for like the full.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the collection to come
out. Yeah, okay. So Vader, for me, if you guys have been watching this show, and I'm curious to see where you stand on this as well, too, Justin. Like, Vader for me started up at such a high peak and then like just took a dip. Like, really, for me, it became like a strange science fiction comic that I was getting bored with. And over the last four issues, has picked up again and has become focused more on Vader and more of his elusiveness and just the way that he's always playing both. He can play both sides if he needs to, and that's certainly the case in this particular issue. And it also leads up to the crossover that they're going to do with the Star Wars issue, which is Vader Down. He's still relentlessly in all the canon stuff, whether it be the novels or these comics. He's relentlessly going after Luke, trying to find out where this kid is, and this. I really enjoyed this issue myself, but how did you feel about it?
Yeah, I thought the issue was really good, and I don't think that you're wrong in your description of the series overall. I think it hit a high point at about, what is it, issue 5 or 6, when he cracks the window and he's talking about he will get Skywalker in the Empire.
Yeah.
I'm surprised at how much I'm enjoying the Inspector character that they've paired Vader with in this series. He was kind of a caricature to me at first. You know, he has a monocle and huge bushy mustache.
Yep.
But he and Vader have formed a team that I'm excited to read.
Right.
And I like that they're keeping Dr. Aphra off to the sides as not a rogue element, but she's beginning to become a little bit more of a mystery element.
Yeah.
You don't quite know which way she's going to go, but I do believe that the writing on the series has picked up a lot.
Yeah.
And I'm enjoying seeing Vader have to deal with the seamier side of the Empire in order to get power back at the solidified part of the
and
Empire.
Not lose his ruthlessness.
Yes.
Yeah.
In fact, he's rediscovering it almost.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Okay, and there's another issue that came out this week, and that's Chewie number 3. I have never wanted a comic book to end as badly as I want this one to end. You know I love Star Wars and everything about it, and I love Chewbacca. He's one of my favorites of all time. There's no need for this comic book. There really isn't. I said it last week or whenever the last issue came out, and I'll say it again. This is a Saturday morning cartoon that I don't believe furthers the new canon or the history of the story. It's literally about him just helping these people get out of a cave. Antonio Banderas is doing it this week.
Well, now
the
I want to read
it. Yeah, you should see the 33. Chewie. Don't worry about Chewbacca. So I just don't care. The illustration's fine. The writing is good. There's nothing against the writing. It's just I just don't care about Chewbacca and helping these people out of a cave.
Yeah, it has the opposite problem of Rebels. It's a story that I feel would have been great for a slightly longer one-shot,
yeah,
but doesn't work for a series so far. That's not to say I'm not enjoying reading it. It's just tough getting through it because not a lot is happening. You summed it up perfectly when you said it's literally about Chewbacca helping people get out of a cave.
Yeah.
I liked the first issue a lot, though.
Yeah. Okay, that's it. Now, here's something that I want to do because I get these tweets all of the time as far as, where do you rank the Star Wars novels? Like, I get, like, how should I start reading if I don't know the new canon? What should I read? What should I check out? So I'm just going to give you a little bit of a, you know, and I'll include the young readers as well here too. And Justin, please, when I'm finished, I'd love to hear your list too, if you've got one that you want to share. And John, same thing. I know that you've read a lot of them, maybe not all of them, but so for me, the very last one that I'm putting in the hole that's never going to get out of there is Heir to the Jedi. It is absolutely the one that should be down there, and it is down there. I think right after that is where Aftermath pops in. I put Aftermath right after Heir to the Jedi. And then I would go with Moving Target, which is the young reader novel from with Leia. After that, I would go with A New Dawn. Then I would go, going back to the young reader novel, I'd go with Smuggler's Run. Then I will go with Tarkin. Then I will go with Weapon of a Jedi, which is a young reader. Then Dark Disciple. Then Battlefront. I put Battlefront up there, actually, right above Dark Disciple. Now that I've gone back, checked it, I really liked what they did. It was like a band of brothers. Then the last two, this to me, it goes back and forth, man. I could tell you that Lords of the Sith is number two and Lost Stars is number one, and then tomorrow I can go say the exact opposite. So today I will say that Lords of the Sith is my number one with Lost Stars at number two. I believe I covered everything there. I didn't leave anything out. But Justin, is there anything that
I'm going to not go into the young adult ones, only because they're not here. It'll be easier for me just to look at the pictures. And I'll start from my number one, which is Lords of the Sith. I almost want to exempt Lost Stars because I feel like there's a handicap. You're going through events you know so well from the original trilogy. It almost has an unfair advantage. Lords of the Sith, Tarkin, and I'd tie Tarkin with Twilight Company. I'm a little biased again. I like The Empire. Dark Disciple underneath that. I would score Aftermath over A New Dawn because I loved the interludes and I really loved the Sinjir story, which is why if Max von Sydow is Sinjir, I won't be disappointed. And then I believe that leaves me with just one, and that's Heir to the Jedi. It's Heir to the Jedi.
It's not good.
Yeah. Okay. If you can only read one, read Lords of the Sith. If you can only read two, read Lords of the Sith and Lost Stars. If you can only read three, Lords of the Sith, Lost Stars, and Tarkin.
Right.
If you can only read four, I'm about 40 pages into it now. I'll go Dark Disciple.
Right.
I got about 40 pages into Battlefront on a flight from New York to L.A., and I was bored, and I put it down. But Christian assures me he gets better.
He does.
So I might try to get. So I'll leave that out. After about 20 other, I don't know, baseball cards and TV commercials, right, I would put Aftermath. I thought it was awful. And right down there with it, maybe just over. And I'll put over. I'll put New Dawn over Aftermath. But you cannot go wrong with Lords of the Sith, with Lost Stars, or with Tarkin. You can't go wrong with any of them.
Yeah, I agree. And well, I think if you're a Clone Wars fan, that you'll really enjoy Dark Disciple. If you want to know the furthering story of both Quinlan Vos and Asajj Ventress. Yeah.
Also, Battlefront excels as an audiobook. I had the same trouble when I was reading it. It took me a while, longer than I anticipated to get through. But if you try the audiobook out, I think you'll like it a lot more.
All right.
Okay. Now, this is where we get to talk to you guys. You guys have been sending in your tweets over the last week or so, or 2 weeks, and we choose them. You guys simply just put hashtag Collider Jedi Council. We pick some. We talk about it. What do we have first, Dennis? Okay. At Gail McGowan says, Star Wars Episode 7 is not doing critic screenings. What is the likelihood of them doing press screenings?
Yes, they are. They are one in the same. Critic screenings and press screenings are the same thing. What was come out, and I don't know if this is actually 100% for sure, but the word out there right now is that they're not doing awards screenings. These are different things. So critic screenings, press screenings are the same thing, and yes, they are doing those. But they are not doing special award screenings, which is irrelevant because anybody who's going to be seeing an award screening is going to be at one of the press screenings anyway.
Right.
So it's really more symbolic than anything else. But there will be press screenings. They are the same thing as critic screenings.
I honestly have nothing to add to that answer. It's perfect. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, I think the same thing, too. I mean, we get a lot, like, people going, oh, so you're not going to be able to go to press screenings, huh? I'm like, no, it said award screenings. Mm-hmm. They're different. Now, look, there very well might not be any press screenings. I don't think that's the case, but I think we will definitely get...
I know there are.
There are.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I think so as well, too, and I think you're 100% right that it's going to happen. But now, how limited that they are, we don't know. I mean, it's very interesting. But yeah, I agree with John. Okay, next up, I believe, is Mike Weaver, 800, who says, what the F is up with the blizzard of spoilers from JJ this week? He needs to stop. I didn't see any spoilers.
I'm not quite sure what he's talking about.
No.
I haven't seen any spoilers.
No, I wouldn't qualify anything he said as spoilers.
There's story details.
You get story details for every movie. It's like, this is where Luke is. That would be a spoiler. But that's not what he's doing, so I don't see it.
It'll be interesting, though, once the film comes out, to compare people's reactions to what really happens in the film, those big reveals,
right,
to what we assume or what we think sometimes are spoilers from the few images we've seen.
Also, Leia is Snoke.
I'd be curious to add up the amount of footage we have and then see what a percentage of the film that actually is.
Right, that's a good point.
We've got to be at like 3%, maybe.
Maybe, and a lot of people think that the majority of stuff that they've shown, minus a few scenes, have been taken from the front
first
of the movie.
First act
anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, next up, we have at Hario72, who says, with the mention of Dark Side Fanatics Kylo Ren, the chance of seeing Moriband / Valley of the Dark Lords. Now, if you don't know what Moriband is, it used to be called Korriban, which is the Sith home planet. It was introduced into new canon as Moriband in the Clone Wars Season 6, when Yoda, of course, went there and visits a great arc if you haven't checked it out. Mm-hmm. I do think that we're going to see Moriband. Now, whether or not we see it in The Force Awakens, I don't know. But I think that Moriband has to be explored, especially if they're doing these artifacts and this Sith Lord like lore and history. I would love to see Moriband. And I know John talked about this once before. Do you think Moriband's going to pop up? Maybe not in Episode 7, but in this new trilogy?
I believe it will. Probably closer to Episode 9.
Okay.
I believe it will, and I believe, once Luke gets introduced, I believe that'll introduce a new arc that will ultimately take us to the secret of Snoke, and that'll all go all the way back to Moriband. Yeah. I think that's where we're going to go.
Justin?
I think it depends on Plagueis. If Plagueis is involved in this trilogy, yes, absolutely, 100%. I feel like we're going to see it. If he's not involved, I think the chances reduce dramatically. And even if it is Plagueis, I go back to the parts of Aftermath that detailed that some people in the Empire had gone off to the fringes to find like a wellspring of Force energy to figure out where the Force came from. That's some Plagueis stuff right there.
Yeah, right.
And so if he's not on Moriband, I would say that he's out there with them.
Okay, next up is at Ren's Rebellion. Love that handle. In Empire, Vader wants Luke to rule with him. Could that be what Kylo wants for the Skywalkers to rule? Absolutely. I think that's one of the main reasons he's going after Rey, whether or not that's his sister or cousin or whoever it is. The family, and the same thing, I will finish what you started. I think that's, he's going to know the history, the full history of Vader and maybe Anakin Skywalker, and really in getting into it about who his grandfather was. And I think that, he's going to want his sibling, cousin, whoever it is, to rule. Do you feel the same way?
Yeah, whether it's a sibling, cousin, or whoever, obviously, you're not the First Order's enforcer, and you're not Kylo Ren and just stopping and you're content being basically a lapdog. Right. He's got to want more, and I think that he is in search of not just the weapon, which I feel is Anakin Luke's lightsaber, but somebody to share that with.
John?
I just think you're right.
Yeah, okay. Fair. Next up, will the credits for The Force Awakens include based on characters and situations created by George Lucas? Great question that really hasn't been... asked. I would assume so.
I think it would need to be.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, the whole universe is out of George Lucas's imagination. Whatever comes out of this universe is based on the work of George Lucas. So maybe not exactly worded like that, but in some there you will have some form of that.
Nice nod.
Like,
acknowledgement. Maybe Simon Pegg will write it. what do you think, Justin?
Aside from you trolling Simon Pegg right now, Absolutely. It's a Star Trek situation based upon Star Trek, created by Gene Roddenberry. It's George Lucas. You can't have a Star Wars movie without his name someplace in the credits.
Great. Okay, three left. How old is Han Solo by the time of Rebels? Is there any chance that we get to see him in the show? I mean, he's not too far off from the age he was in New Hope, because it was only about 3 years before New Hope, I believe. So he's around the same age, give or take 3 years, from
maybe 27,
along the lines. I think that is very possible. Whether you see him in season two or three, you're going to see Han Solo. At one point, I think they went to that kid Anthony Ingruber to voice him in Rebels for an arc that just never panned out. I think that that will happen again, and I think Anthony Ingruber will wind up voicing him, but I don't know if that's going to happen in season two or three. John?
I think three. I think it's going to happen. I think it's going to happen in three.
Justin?
I have no idea.
Okay.
I think he's going to make an appearance. I just don't know when it is. I think it depends on a lot of the Rebel Alliance stuff that they're building right now. They've already got
Freddy?
Lando there.
What is it, Freddy?
Let's ask Freddy.
Just tell us.
Yeah, just
tweet us. You got our Twitter. Send us. Tell us what it is.
Okay, so here's a question for you guys. At DRich71, name three directors you would live to see. Oh, excuse me. You would like to see helm a Star Wars film. Okay, for me, it's pretty easy. I've got I got Matthew Vaughn up there for sure. I've got Jon Favreau, and I have Alex Garland. Those are my three that I'm going with.
I would just replace Garland, which would be great. That would be fine, too, which is Steven Spielberg.
Justin?
I'd like to see Catherine Bigelow, Zero Dark Thirty, right?
Yeah,
I'd like to see her helm a Star Wars film.
Okay. All right, last question here. This is from at Jack Washburn, who says, is it possible that George Lucas has a clause in his contract with Disney that the prequels couldn't be redone?
No doubt.
Yeah.
I have no doubt about that. Like, you want Star Wars? That's good.
You can't touch
this. And look, I'm going to tell you right now, that contract is this thick. It's that thick. And part of that is the amount of zeros of the amount of money George is still going to get from Star Wars movies as the things progress. So I'm still reading all these jokes online. Hey, what was it that just sold for $4 billion? Candy Crush sold for more money than Star. Like, don't think for a second that dollar figure you saw that Disney gave to George in stock and cash, that it ends there. Don't think for a second. But I have no doubt a part of that is either A, you can never touch the prequels.
Right. Jar Jar lives.
Or his films. I mean, any of his films. You can't touch them. Or B, that plus without my permission.
Right.
So I'm sure that is absolutely, because that's his legacy. Whether the parts of it we love, the parts we don't love, it doesn't matter if we love or don't love. It's his. So I'm sure he protected that when he made those deals.
Justin?
Yeah. I'm sure, as John said, that probably exists. I think the larger question is, Disney doesn't want to touch the prequels, I feel like, with a 10-foot pole. The prequels, as much as people hate on them, turned into, in the interim between Revenge of the Sith and today, the Star Wars universe for a lot of younger fans.
Yeah.
So the prequels continue to make a lot of money through the form of the Clone Wars, through the form of other characters. I mean, Ahsoka Tano is a product of the prequels.
Yeah.
So I think the bigger question is, would they ever want to remake them? No. They've got the Star Wars they want, and they'd be fools to go back to it.
Yeah, I think you're right. And it was a question that came up that John and Mark Ellis and John Schnepp talked about the other day on Movie Talk as well. That conversation was brought up. And there's no reason to touch them. They're just, no matter what you think about the movies, it has, like what Justin was saying, it has really, they have the history of it, and they would have to change books then, and they'd have to change comics, and they'd have to change all these things that it's a part of their history.
It's canon now. Once they slide, look, no, me and Simon Pegg, all right? I don't know, there's two other people out there who hate the prequels as much as we do, but I will sit here and tell you, I will defend the prequels and say, once they put that label of canon on it, yes, and here's my analogy. They're that drug-addicted, alcoholic, 47-year-old uncle who still lives in your grandmother's basement. They're an embarrassment to the family, but they're still family.
Right.
And that's the prequels. I will say, you cannot touch the prequels. They are canon now, and once you put that canon label on them, that label is there for a reason. That means everything that comes after it is built on it, so if you mess with it, you're messing with everything that comes after.
Agreed.
So, no, don't touch them.
Yeah. Okay. But before we leave and before we say goodbye,
percentages.
We are not going to forget the percentages today.
We always
forget the percentages. John has a percentage game that he plays with the council. We like to try to do it every week. We've forgotten the last couple of weeks. John, please.
Okay. So the game that we started a while ago and we forget like every other week to play, I'm going to refine the game. I'm going to change it up a little bit.
Okay.
Because the game used to be a percentage, 0 to 100%. How certain are we, or what do we feel are the chances? that Kylo Ren and Rey are related. I'm changing the game.
Okay, what you got?
Because I think across the board, we're all pretty much 100% in agreement. They're related.
You said, the percentage was brother and sister.
Well, see, I thought I did, but then somebody corrected me and said I said related.
No.
So whatever. So yeah. And then we went to related. Now I'm going to go make sure we're back on brother and sister.
Yeah, okay.
Now, so we're all pretty much 100% in agreement. They're going to be related.
Yeah, because I think they're related,
for sure. The question now is, the percentage that they are brother and sister, I am going to come in on this little thing at 98% that they are indeed siblings.
Justin.
98.3%.
Oh, he goes over me.
I'll take one of those numbers, 3%.
Really?
3% that they're brothers. A brother and sister, I would say about 90.
I think it's 3% that they're brothers as well.
Yes. Brothers, yeah. I would say 99.9% that they're cousins. And I don't know.
I got to ask, do you really believe that Disney would allow Luke Skywalker to be a, for all intents and purposes, a deadbeat dad?
It's a matter of if it was protective, if he was looking after her, if there was a way that he thought that was going to protect her,
as a child was abandoned.
We also don't know
his protection.
We don't know the history of what's happened.
Which is why I feel like they wouldn't do that. But
maybe we don't. But if it tells the right story, I think though too, and I think that they want to get away from this thing the Jedi can't love. Get away from that. It was a bad thing that happened in the prequels. It's silly.
Luke's one foray into love, though, was with his sister. I think it's good that
they
let that go.
But he backed off once he realized what was going on. But that's it, guys. That is today's episode of Collider Jedi Council. I would like to thank the council who joined us today, our very special guest, Justin Bolger. Where can they find you on the internet?
You can find me on the internet at theforce.net, where I write and podcast about Star Wars. I also do a Walking Dead podcast called Dead Talks, which you can find at deadtalks.com. And if you want to reach out to me on Twitter, you can find me at TheApexFan.
And Obi-John Kenobi, John Campia, where can they find you?
You can find me Monday through Friday, of course, on Movie Talk on the weekend, Saturdays and Sundays on Mailbag, on Tuesdays on Heroes, on Thursdays right here at Rebels. Also on Tuesdays, find me on the Flash Recap Show, and on Wednesdays on the Rebels Recap Show, and a lot of other things that we got going on around here. You can follow me on Facebook or on Twitter, simply at John Campia.
And for me, Darth Harloff, you can find me at Kristian Harloff on both Twitter and Instagram. You can find me here at Movie Talk. And like John said, well, obviously here on Jedi Council and on Rebels and a whole bunch of other things all over the internet. Check that out. Now, one of the things I want to do is, remember when you guys made Freddie Prinze Jr. happen? When you guys made Freddie Prinze Jr. happen by tweeting like maniacs? Well, I got somebody else for you to do it to. We're going to do it again this time and see how it works. It's Kevin Smith time.
We want Kevin Smith on this show. So we want Kevin Smith on this show.
What we would love for you guys to do is simply tell Kevin Smith, who's at that Kevin Smith, that hey Kevin, you should be a guest on Collider Jedi Council. Make it happen. Let's make Kevin Smith come on the show and talk about the journey to The Force Awakens. Thank you guys. Make sure you comment, tell us what subject matters we talked about today that you're most interested in, and we'll see you next week on Collider Jedi Council. May the Force be with you.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.